Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ginger Broderick, and I'm the host of the Ginger New York TV show. Welcome to Ginger Fridays at MNN TV Studios. We are launching off our 8th year of weekly show, so thanks for joining in. We have a great show for you today. It's an especially exciting show because someone who's been on my secret wish list for a long time is actually here in the house. It is Mark Hudson. He is a Grammy-winning award singer, songwriter, and
producer,
that's the word I was looking for.
Pole dancer,
wow. And also, he was the musical director for Sir Ringo Starr, so that's really awesome. And we also have Gary Burr here. He is a Nashville songwriter. He is in the Nashville Songwriter Hall of Fame. He has a great show that's called Nashville to New York. I saw it earlier this week, and boy, oh boy, am I glad to have you all here. Thank you so much.
Nice to be here.
Oh,
hello.
Glad to be here.
Hi. Good. I know you, Mark, for a long time. I saw you at the Beatles Fest, and I said, boy, I'd love to have him on my show one
day.
Here
I am.
And then a thanks to your publicist, Susan Russo. She coordinated
Nothing without her.
Oh, she's wonderful.
Yeah.
She's really right on the mark. She reviews.
I get it. Right on the
mark.
See what you did there?
I was funny. I didn't even know it.
Well, you see?
There you go. And Gary, when I got a ticket for the Cutting Room on Tuesday, I didn't even know. Didn't know it was you.
You didn't know what
I walked
in for.
I was like, oh my God, Gary's my guest.
Oh,
and it
great.
Was hilarious. What a great show.
That's a good show. That's a good show. Every 3 months we show up at the Cutting Room, whether we're booked or not.
Oh, wonderful. Okay.
Don't worry, I'll laugh where they're supposed to be. I'll help you out.
I
had to think about
there,
that one.
Okay. Out there, they're laughing.
No, they're chuckling.
So, how did the two of you meet?
Oh, that's
fourth
a
grade?
Fascinating
yes,
story.
Yes, we actually were signed to the same publisher.
Yep.
Oh.
And they sent me out to write with him.
Uh-huh.
And I didn't get it. I mean, we didn't really click. It was like, okay, but it was just this sort of...
you know why? Because I was really on the rock side.
Yes.
At that point, he was writing country hits.
Yeah.
And so it was this sort of like, well, let's just put them together and see what happens.
Oh.
Yeah. And I thought, oh, no, another guy from the South that has seen a spaceship.
And I thought, oh, no, another rock guy that's going to want to write songs about psychedelic unicorns.
And the two of you wrote many hits for Sir Ringo.
We did. When I was producing Ringo, and we'd always talk about the Beatles whenever we were together. And I just said, the perfect guy for our band is Gary Burr. I called up Gary and said, let's go. And then we became the two songwriters. Ringo would fly us to London.
Wonderful.
And we would stay at his house and we would start writing the...
We bonded.
Yes, it was
That's
good.
That's great.
Yeah.
I see your similar sense of humor.
And,
but I didn't understand the music. But I didn't understand what the genres of music.
He's the balloon that kind of floats in the wind, and I'm the guy left here holding the string.
Absolutely. So Gary has wind, and I'm the balloon.
And Mark, you've been in showbiz since, I mean, I was little.
Since I was a sperm cell.
Yeah.
I used to be in black and white.
Well, I actually, you know, I'm in the generation of, I knew Sonny and Cher. I knew you guys popped in after that.
Well, the Hudson Brothers, we were regulars on the Sonny and Cher show. And then they gave us the summer replacement.
Yeah.
And the next thing you know, we became... And you know what the scary part of it is, in a serious note? We were musicians first.
Uh-huh.
You know, signed to Elton John's label, Bernie Taupin producing. And the television thing, at that point, the Monkees and the Partridge Family, they were all
Osmond.
Actors. Yeah, they were actors doing music. And it kind of diluted our musical career.
Oh,
because they said, oh, those funny, zany guys. And that became... like an imbalance, actually, at that time period.
Oh, isn't that interesting?
It isn't anymore, but now it was then.
It was at that time.
Yeah, but it was great. I mean, all those...
He spent a lot of his career diluted.
I did. I got very close with Cher, too.
I love her.
Oh, me too. More here.
You
heard some of the story.
Yes,
no.
Do you do Cher?
I do. Mr. Ed. She's great.
Oh, we all love her.
And the last time I kissed her, I slid off her lips. I mean, there was more gloss there than... Yeah. Gary's 8x10.
Wow.
Got this, sorry.
That's
so you know the real thing is, we have fun with each other. We don't really care whether
there's a
camera.
Well, I didn't even think I was necessary for today.
No, you need to hold down the fort. But when we're together, all we really try to do is one-up each other on who's getting the punchline.
Oh.
The other night we were in the tub together and we said, you know what would be funny?
Right.
Never mind. I'll go into that.
Okay.
So you guys have a show coming up next week at the Triad.
What?
Yeah.
We do.
We should be here. We should be rehearsing. What are we doing here?
Because we'll do something over there when we go play. You know what the thing is? We try to look at, because we harmonize, I mean, Ringo's band and stuff, our harmonies were great. We have a friend, Mark Miranda.
Yes.
A singer-songwriter.
He's my new Facebook friend.
Yeah.
He doesn't know I'm a stalker.
but he's incredible, too. And when the three of us, we did a Beatle Fest once, and we did This Boy, and the harmony was so great.
Yeah.
We thought, why don't we just get three old guys in a car with our acoustic guitars, and let's do a tribute to Crosby, Stills, and Nash, the best harmony band ever in rock and roll. So we decided, let's do it. So Wednesday, the 9th, we're at the Triad.
It's our kickoff show.
Yeah.
We're
going to
see what happens.
We don't know what it's going to be yet. So it's on 72nd between Broadway and Columbus, 7:30, and we're going to do this show, which could either be a disaster or
I'm
brilliant.
Sure. Oh, I'm sure it's going to be great.
Mm-hmm.
You guys are so funny. I mean,
well, it'll be fun no matter what, and we love the music, and we're not trying to, we don't have a band, so we can't like totally recreate every song exactly, but we're doing a loving homage to three and four guys that we love their body of work.
Right. It's like Gary said, it's sort of like, when Crosby, Stills, and Nash first started out, they would sit in Mama Cass's house, and they just would like play guitars and sing songs.
Jam.
And that's what we're trying to make this, is sort of like a love fest to a small audience of people that care enough to hear that incredible music.
That's great.
Yeah.
I have a ticket already for another venue, but I'm scratching that and going to your show.
Oh, yeah.
Don't make me come over there later. You better show up.
That's great. And you've also written a lot of hit songs for Aerosmith.
I did.
Can you tell us a little story about how that song came about?
Living on the Edge.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
That's wonderful. It was. I've heard it many times, but
Gary's heard it so much he usually falls asleep.
I may slump down on the floor,
like
but the camera
Tuesday.
Can follow.
Let
yeah.
me tell the story.
I'd like to invite you all to follow me down at about the 8-minute mark. Actually, that's what we call him, 8-minute mark.
We'll leave my sex life out of this.
Boom, boom. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Tip the waitress, try the veal.
Yeah. We're here all a minute.
You notice me? You just let them out and they float.
I didn't think there could be crickets in a TV studio, but I literally heard crickets.
Well, see, the thing was this. I was a songwriter, and an A&R guy called me up and said, hey, do you want to work with Aerosmith? And I went, are you kidding? America's greatest rock and roll band? Yeah. Now, as songwriters, our gig really is when we're going to co-write with somebody, we get into the artist's music, kind of figure out what key they sing in, what riffs they do, and you kind of know where their heads are at. So I went and I learned all of the Aerosmith guitar riff, and they sing in this key, and this is what it is, so I was prepared. They fly me to Boston. I go to Joe Perry's house, where the studio was in his basement, and there he was standing, like, black leather vest, a waxed chest with his hair in front of a cigarette. And when I actually saw him, I made a noise like, yeah, because he was like beautiful and a rock god. It was kind of overwhelming. Now, as you can tell, even you kids at home, I can talk to shrubbery. I don't need an audience. I have this conversation in my car.
I know, I didn't need to be here.
No, we need you here.
I really...
And Joe Perry is really shy. He's kind of quiet, plays guitar like angry and scary, but as a human, he's quiet. So I was trying to be conversational like, hey, Joe, what a great studio. Yeah. Joe, you think the Boston Red Sox will ever beat the Yankees? Yeah. And because
it's incredible.
Because they're from Boston, I went, how about some chowder? Should we get some clam chowder? Yeah. And I'm thinking to myself as a songwriter, oh my God, this is going to be like a root canal of the longest day of my life. Car pulls up, door opens, and there he is backlit like a Spielberg movie, holding a model airplane. Yeah. Steven Tyler. He comes in with his childbearing lips, two different tennis shoes, and I hit it off with him, boom, immediately. You can laugh, just chuckle, because Gary won't. So I hit it off with him immediately. He goes, play me some stuff. And I played some of the stuff that I had worked on to bring to them, and they liked it. But I didn't see any sort of major thrust of, oh, that's incredible. Because they were kind of hearing Aerosmith-esque songs. And Steven had the insight to go, let me ask you a question. What would you bring to the band if you were in the band.
That's pretty serious.
Oh, are you kidding? Thank God I was wearing brown pants, because I was scared. Like, you didn't even know. Like, oh, my God.
I noticed you're wearing yellow.
So I'm safe. I didn't know. I had this song. And being the Beatle freak that I am, and John Lennon was my reason for living, I had written this thing. Something's wrong with the world today. I don't know what it is, thinking of John. Something's wrong with our eyes. And it was Living on the Edge. Stephen goes, stop, stop. John Lennon's in the room. Yeah! And he screamed, and his mouth was so big, Donald Trump was having lunch on his tongue. It was just a frightening meal. Mm-hmm. You're allowed to laugh too, don't be jaded.
No, I understand.
This wasn't funny. And anyway, so from that point, the song ended up writing itself. It became this huge hit, and from that, everybody wanted to work with me from something that I brought to the table that I wasn't prepared to
do. Gee
whiz. And that's what's great about
songwriting. You're channeling John Lennon, because he was such a big influence.
And he was saying, remember, John Lennon was the last guy that was saying stuff, because at that point, all of the music was, let's hear it for the boys, and Footloose. It was like white people clapping on the 1 and 3. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, Lennon would always go Imagine or Instant Karma. Mm-hmm. And Living on the Edge was Something's Wrong with the World Today. It had a political mm-hmm. thing to it. It actually makes more sense now with what's going on in our world than it did when I first wrote it.
That was in the early 90s, right?
Yeah, 93.
Yeah, wow, and you won a Grammy. Congratulations.
Yeah, it was great. I gave it to my mom.
Did you?
Well, it's an award. Yeah. I got it. My best award was for pole dancing. And you think that's stripping, but I was dancing with Polish people.
Oh, that's sort of,
it's an outreach program. It's a kind of a UN sanctioned thing. Yeah. I give you a lot of kudos for it.
Thank you, Gary.
So I found out that you're a drummer, that you're originally a drummer.
Yeah.
I'm a big drummer fan. I find these things out.
I started out as a drummer. And that's why, you know, working with Ringo, which we got to do. Remember, when we were recording with him, I was playing bass.
I couldn't imagine it.
I mean, and there's like right 4 feet in front of us is a Beatle. And I knew every drum lick that he ever played. And there was one time when they were doing the number one album at Abbey Road. I was there with Ringo, George Martin was there with his son, and they're putting it together. And I hear this track, and I go, oh, those are the drums from Octopus's Garden.
Oh, my goodness.
And Ringo goes, no, they're not. I went, yes, they are. No, they're not. Yes, they are. No, they're not, you bastard. And I went, and George Martin turned around and said, Richard, they're from Octopus's Garden.
Whoa.
And Ringo just darted this look at me, took his drumsticks and signed them to me, and said, here, just don't sell them at Sotheby's. Because I knew more. He says, you know more about me than I do.
Wow. See, they had a tribute to him at the last Beatle Fest, and it was incredible on some of the fans who know more, or he's learned from them. You know, like your story now.
But also, he was a left-handed drummer. Uh-huh. So, you know, he played a right-handed kit. And as a left-handed person, he would always lead with his left hand.
Oh, that's something.
And that's one of those things.
All his drum fills sound interesting.
Yeah,
a lot of drummers go, boy, I wouldn't have played it like that. Yeah. It's because he leads with his left.
Well, I'm learning the guitar and the bass guitar. And so that's how I got an interest in songwriting and paid attention to what you're doing.
Hmm.
And I found out you're a bass guitarist.
I have been. I toured for years with and played guitar and bass with Carole King.
Good for you.
And
these are like icons.
Yeah, I know. It is pretty amazing. Believe me, we're as stunned as anybody.
I was just going to ask, do you pinch yourself?
We think of that. You know, you go, I mean, the only good thing about the gig is there was very little learning involved, because we learned all these songs when we were about 12.
Yeah, we knew them from when we were kids.
Know? Right. He gives the set list and goes, here's what you have to learn. He goes, got it.
But you know, the weird thing about it is sometimes when you're sitting there and you're with these iconic people, you're so on the inside of the music that we don't really realize the joy of, like, he's playing guitar and he looks over and there she is. Morning. She is singing a Carole King song, and it's Carole King
singing it. Wow.
And but Fa-na-na the Morning is not the original lyric, actually. That was just...
I do lyrics.
Yeah. Yeah,
I'm a rapper.
He's quite adept.
I'm very deep.
And you have a lovely wife, Georgia.
Georgia Middleman. Yes, that's right.
And lovely
hit songwriter and fabulous singer.
When I was listening to your show, your tone and your voice was like, wow, that reminds me of Kenny Rogers.
Yeah, and as I get older, I hear that.
Do you? Yeah, yeah. Oh, I heard it right
away. I always hear Mr. Rogers. That's what they say to me. Yeah. You're more like, won't you be my neighbor?
I straddle the fence between Kenny and Mr.
And I thought, you're our modern-day Kenny and Dolly.
Now, wait a second. That was really, he just did something. Because rarely is
did
it
I
complete.
Miss something?
No, as the king of comedy, I'm always sort of judging. He said, say it one more time because it's really incredible.
I said, I straddle the fence between Kenny and Mr.
Oh,
Rogers. See, and that,
but I missed that.
If you have to repeat it, it ain't funny.
It was funny. It'd still be funny.
George and I have a blast singing and writing together.
You can
and
see it.
It's to be self-contained like that. And we travel all over the country doing, you know, corporate shows and things like that. And it's just great. You know, it's the most fun we have is when we get to sing
That's
together. And then to bring other people in, we're able to put, you know, because she sings with me with Carol, too. So, you know, we're sort of a little harmony machine. So if somebody else comes in, we can
good
make them
you.
Sound good.
And you know what else is great about her? She's also, Georgia has a theatrical.
Does she talk to you?
Oh, yeah. No, she does. We're very, very, very close. No, they let me in the house.
Yeah, it's our dog that doesn't let me in the house. She went to NYU to study acting.
Yeah, see, and that's the thing, and, because she has this theatrical thing about her where she
lovely.
Really knows, when I say how to sell it, great songwriter, great singer, but she also has that
presence,
other ingredient that like connects to an audience.
Oh yeah, she was
you
very
have
engaging.
To have that. You have to have something that engages the audience. You can't, you know, it's like our show coming up. It's like it can't just be three guys sitting on a stool singing. So we're gonna tell some of the stories behind the song, some of the stories that, you know, and what we don't know. What's great is what we don't know, we make up.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
So you and Georgia also have master classes in songwriting. Do I understand that correctly?
Yes.
Occasionally.
I actually have the master class.
Okay.
It's an online class.
Oh.
And you know, if anybody wants to go to www.writesongsgood.com, then there's three free videos on there about songwriting.
Oh wow.
And that's a entree into this big online master class that I offer. That you know, I like to say it's everything about songwriting from A to B.
And it's great, too, because also, you know, even when we're writing together, there's actually, like, there's a way to write a song. You know, it's like Diane Warren, the most famous female songwriter on the planet, would say, don't bore us, get to the chorus.
Oh, okay.
But then there was American Pie, which was 89 verses before it got to the chorus. Gary has this thing where he knows the form and then can break the form. And when you get taught that by a guy that's had that many hits, you go, wow. Really? You can do that? And he, wait, what's the thing when you yell about John Lennon? Remember we had this discussion about a lyric in Imagine where he repeats a repeat?
Well, it's just kind of funny. Everybody thinks that, you know, everybody's afraid in songwriting to make mistakes. But some of the biggest hits I've ever had have some glaring mistakes in them that I wish I had a time machine to go and fix. And I always point out that there's a glaring lyrical mistake in Imagine, one of the most famous songs, where in the chorus he rhymes one with one.
Oh, isn't that something?
Which is really easy. And there's no rhyme for orange or colostomy bag. And if you can balance those two.
Yeah, yeah. I think pretty much we can end the lesson there.
Isn't that something?
Because
one of the interesting things, like for you, you get hired to write songs like for a particular person. Like you study them.
Yeah.
But there is also, like Georgia was talking about, that you write a song and it's just out there for someone to listen to.
There's,
how do
there's,
you pitch
when
that?
When you write a song for someone, then you have the chance to like study their work and try to aim the arrow right from the get-go.
Okay.
A lot of times you're just shooting the arrow and then you're running ahead with the target going, I wonder where it is, and you're kind of thinking, who could do this song?
Okay.
And that's fun too. It's fun to write a song just to see what comes out and at the end of it go, is there anybody out there that would record this song?
Wow.
Because a lot of times the weird songs, every time I pitch a song to somebody, like a famous artist, I always give them exactly what I think they want. And then the one song that I think they'll never cut.
Oh,
and it's a surprise how often
they are
intrigued and take the song that in a million years you never thought they'd cut.
That's interesting.
Well, it's actually I wrote a song with Carole King that we gave to Aerosmith. And Stephen loved it.
Wow.
And Joe Perry hated it.
Oh.
So when that happens, and it's a band, you just watch your song fly out the window.
Wow.
So we lost the cut. So I'm thinking, wow, it was such a great song and went away. 4 months later, I get a phone call going, you know, Mark, you know that song you wrote with Carole King? And I went,
Who's talking to you?
My publisher.
Okay.
Say, you know that song you wrote with, because they pitched it to Aerosmith, and then Stephen loved it, and Glenn Ballard, who was producing, loved it. Joe hated it, and it was gone.
Oh.
So I'm thinking it's going to end up in a drawer. 4 months later, the phone call comes in and goes, you know that song you wrote with Carole King? Yeah. Celine Dion just cut it. And I went, and I knew she was popular. She was like she looked like a Q-tip, a skinny Quebecian that hits her chest when she sings. And I know that she's great. And she goes, and the record's on her Titanic album.
Oh, my goodness.
So this thing that I thought was a failure sells 26 million copies.
God bless.
Oh, it was so great. And there was a lyric in there. And, you know, and Carole King is like a force to be reckoned with, as we both know. And there's a lyric in there going, I'm going down because I adore you. I want to floor you. And I wrote that for the double entendre to be, I want to floor you like bada bing, or I want to floor you where you're so impressed by me that you're floored by me. And Carole King went, no, we're not doing floored. And I went, but Carole, it's sort of it's a metaphor for two different things. No. I said, I'm telling you, we sent the demo. She cut the song. And when Carole and I met Celine Dion, she went, my favorite part, I want to floor you. And I went,
to get Cher?
No, Cher is Mark Arrow.
Okay.
No, I'm trying to do Quebecian. She went, I want to floor you. And I looked at Carole and I went, don't mess with the king. She goes, no, I'm the king, you're the queen.
Oh.
All right, okay. But a failure that became a success without even knowing it.
Listen, we've been talking a long time. And I
are we out of time now?
Almost, but I want to get some music in before.
Wait, don't we have more things to plug? Aren't you playing at a Bluebird thing at somewhere?
Oh yeah, somewhere. I think July 20th.
July 20th at City Opry.
We're playing at that new City Opry in Times Square.
Good
up at
you.
In the big songwriting room.
Wow.
Georgia and me and the lovely Victoria Shaw, who wrote The River for Garth Brooks.
Great.
And but yeah, we can go over there and
play.
But
love
we
to
do
have
that,
you guys come
May
back.
May 24th. At the Iridium here in New York, 51st and Broadway. I do like a
Thursdays on the Hudson.
Thursday on the Hudson, and I invite friends in the audience, like Timothy B. Schmidt from the Eagles or Carmen Appice from Vanilla Fudge.
Can you tell us who's up this time?
Earl Slick.
Ooh.
From John Lennon and David Bowie. And then I found this kid who came up and hugged me on the street, and he looked like an ant. Tony Vincent, he's in that rock show, Rocktopia.
Oh.
And I hadn't known him for a while. He was like, Mark!
Oh,
and he's like, he's hugging me. And I thought he was a tick. But he's got an incredible voice.
Yeah, I saw the show twice.
And I'm inviting him, too.
Oh, how wonderful.
So we'll do like Purple Haze.
The drummer, the wonderful.
Yeah, May 24th, the Iridium.
That's great. My brother's going to be in town that night. And so we're going to go. I'm going to miss my bass guitar class that night for your show.
I'll let you come up and play bass.
What's your wish for? Come on, you heard it.
Yeah.
You heard it. That's a commit. That's as good as commit you get from this guy.
You're in.
I'm learning a Led Zeppelin song now, right?
Ooh,
I know.
Cashmere?
No. Confused and Dazed. Dazed and Confused.
Gotta get the title right first. That's the first step for a good
bass
player.
Songwriting, no, songwriting.
Let's play that Shout and Twist song.
You guys gotta come back. There's many more stories.
The crickets are still out there.
You missed one more. You said Confused and Dazed, and then he said, maybe we can play
that Shout and Twist song.
Which is Twist and Shout.
Yeah. All right.
I should have messed.
Okay, so we're playing this Garagey Stills and Nash and Young show next week on Wednesday night at the Triad.
72nd.
So we're gonna give you a tiny sample a little medley of that, and then maybe we'll have time to hear that big hit song that Mark wrote. So this is kind of what we're going to be doing. We could do the chorus of
Woodstock.
Of Woodstock.
Written by Joni Mitchell, by the way.
Okay, ready?
One,
two, three. Stardust, golden. See, the chorus really doesn't work without the lead vocal.
So, if you don't hear that, we got to get ourselves.
Yeah, you're really missing the core part without Mirando here. But maybe you should just play your Aerosmith.
I think so, too.
Yeah. But come next Wednesday, and we'll have all three voices, and you'll suddenly go, oh, that's what those
that
songs
makes
are
sense.
Supposed to sound like.
And even a little bit of let's just do one twinge of Ohio. Is that possible or is not?
I'm not tuned the right way. So
you who run.
That's not Ohio. That's Nebraska.
Listen to the silence.
You want a little teach?
Yeah, go.
That's so pretty with that third part.
That third part, we're going
to... I'm telling you, you owe it to yourself, really. You owe it to yourself.
Okay.
Now, wasn't there a famous song that you were going to play?
Yeah, there was. And if you get a chance, and Gary, you'll do the riff, right?
Yep.
Okay. And you know what's great? We don't really want to be so professional that it's frightening. The looseness...
A little danger of that.
The looseness, the looseness of us is our charm.
That's also going to be our biography. It's called The Looseness of Us.
I'll play music now because of the silence in the audience. We'll wait for Gary to tune. And you know, it was really weird because I said that this song makes more sense now. And I guess that's really the thing about writing a song is that is what is with us for the rest of our lives, our grandchildren. And you can go back to Sinatra, Rudy Valley, the Beatles, the Stones, Joni Mitchell, name who you want, Aretha. All of that music is here beyond us. I was blessed to and lucky enough to write this song, and it makes a lot of sense.
Go for it.
Something wrong with the world today. I don't know what it is. Something's wrong with our eyes. We're seeing things in a different way, and God knows it ain't his. It sure ain't no surprise. We're living on the edge. You can't stop yourself from falling. Yeah. We're living on the edge. You can't help yourself at all. We're living on the edge. Something wrong with the world today. The light bulb is getting dim. This meltdown in the sky.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
If you can judge a person by the color of his skin, Mister, you're a better man than I. We're living on the edge.
You can't help yourself from falling.
Living on the edge. Situation, complications, aggravations are getting to you. Yeah! If Chicken Little tell you that the sky is falling, even if it wasn't, would you still come crawling back again? I bet you would, my friend.
How many times?
Again and again and again and again. Something's wrong with the world today.
You're hanging on.
Gassy.
Hurt. Living on the edge.
You can't help yourself from falling. Living on the edge. You can't help yourself.
never, never gonna help yourself. You can't help yourself from fun. Yeah, 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 yeah.
Well, guys, we're running out of time, but we're going to do some after-show taping, so stay here.
Great.
I just want to thank you so much
Absolutely.
For going.
We're glad to be
thank you so
thank
much.
You.
Thank
so
you.
So fun.
Much.
Please come back.
Peace and love, everybody.
Yeah, bring Georgia.
We'll see Absolutely. You around when you bend over.
Oh,
what?
Mark.
I apologize.
Be careful.
I can't. It's a daytime show.
Thank you, everyone. My name is Ginger Broderick. I'm the host of Ginger New York. We're here every Friday afternoon at 2 p.m., so thanks a lot for joining in this afternoon show. We're going to...
Ginger... Ginger, 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 here in New York, ginger, I wanna come and say it.
Cool, I got it.
Go get your bass, Ginger, we'll make a record.